I'm Dr. John Zeisel. I believe that staying engaged in our communities, that continuing to learn, and that knowing we can make a difference, hope, are the secrets of successful aging. Welcome to Hopeful Aging. The mission of this program is to create a life worth living for all of us as we age, including people living with cognitive issues, through enriching lives and offering hope. My guest today is Ellen Soares, who is the docent program manager at the Peabody Essex Museum in Salem, Massachusetts. Welcome, Ellen.
Thank you, John. Hi.
So let's start, because I've become somewhat familiar with the term docent from working with you and others in museums. What does the term mean? Where does it come from? And
yeah.
When somebody says the docent in a museum.
It's a bit of an obscure word. It's certainly well known in the art museum world, but outside of that, when I tell people I'm the docent program manager, they don't necessarily have any idea what that means. Docent, the word docent, it seems to be an old word that came into, that means volunteer teacher.
Huh.
And we see it starting to be used in the late 1800s when the Museum of Fine Arts and the Metropolitan Museum of Art really started programs where they had people who were guiding visitors through the museum, helping them understand what was on exhibition. And so docents came into use then, the way that it's used now, as a guide, and usually typically through an art museum.
But why do they have to be volunteers? What's the point of the volunteering rather than say, I'm a paid guide? Why is that important?
I think museums, they have a lot of things that need to be done and often don't have the resources to be able to do everything that they hope without the use of volunteers. A strong volunteer base is key to, I think, to a museum's success for a number of reasons. Just support in the community and help a museum do the things that they want to do. I think for the museum docents, I think they want to volunteer, they want to give back, they want to be involved in an interesting organization that's exciting.
Right.
One of the benefits of being a docent is the learning, the behind-the-scenes look you get at a museum or another place.
So they're sort of in the museum when it's closed, and they can see the artwork, they can understand the artwork.
Yeah, yeah. If you're an outgoing person, as our docents are, you know, it's really fun. You meet people from all over the world. You meet experts in different things. You interact with 5-year-olds.
Right.
You interact with 105-year-olds.
So they get a lot out of it.
They get a lot out of it.
And actually, just for the audience sake, mm-hmm. the intro to this program has about 30 seconds of a museum tour.
Right.
Now, that museum tour is taking place at the Peabody Essex Museum.
Yes.
And it's part of our I'm Still Here Foundation program called Artists for Alzheimer's, or ARTS, A-R-T-Z. Now, you participate in that.
Yes, and we're thrilled to be part of the museum network in the Boston area.
A network, so it's not just you.
No, there are other museums that participate in this program. I think there are now around 6 or 7 or 8. There's a number of them from the Institute of Contemporary Art, Fuller Craft Museum.
Yes.
Museum of Science.
So the tours are not every
no,
week.
No, they come.
When are they?
The visitors come, people involved in this program,
right.
They come to our museum once every 5 or 6 weeks.
Wow, okay,
on a
great.
Tuesday morning.
What time do they get there?
11 o'clock.
So if people want to find out more about this, they can go to your website, right?
They can go to our website, or they can go to the
Foundation website.
Right.
Both of these are at the end of the program, your website
right.
as well. As
yes.
When I say yours, it's the Peabody Essex Museum, so it's www.pem.org.
Yes.
And
yeah.
That's how you can find out about membership and all these
right.
things.
Right.
So the docents who get involved, and these are programs mostly, these arts programs for people with some facing cognitive challenges, like we talked about in the intro. What do they get out of it? What do the docents get out of it? Because we're dealing with your group,
right.
your gang.
And I know that for the docents that are involved in this program, they find it personally extremely fulfilling. I think they enjoy meeting the groups and talking to them and interacting. In fact, these are really interesting people. They get an excellent training with members of the arts staff. But I think the main reason that they're involved is because they just find it so fulfilling to introduce the museum to new audiences.
Have any of them been sort of transformed by it? I mean, because part of the reason for the program is to be somewhat transformative.
I think that one of the docents at least has been transformed. She has a dog that she takes to various nursing homes and assisted living, sort of pet therapy, and I know she was really enjoying that. And I would say that for all of the docents involved, whether they actually think about it in transformative way, I think they were transformed by meeting people with cognitive disabilities and then understanding that they're actually people.
And doing things in a setting that's normalized.
Exactly. Yeah.
So what do they do when on a tour? What you said that the docents work with children, with adults. How are the tours that you give for the children versus adults who are older? How do they differ and what are they about? And what's the essence of any of those tours and how do you tailor them for people with dementia?
Well, we do try to tailor them for the audience that we're working for,
right,
or working with. And for people with cognitive disabilities or older people with cognitive disabilities, we keep in mind a couple of things. We keep in mind, first and foremost, comfort, visitor comfort. And our museum is pretty large, and anyone, regardless of age, to tromp through the whole museum is pretty grueling.
Right.
So we try to pick a gallery or two that we think is going to be particularly interesting for the group we have. We sometimes take the groups from the Arts Museum Network into the museum's Art and Nature Center, where we have exhibitions basically mostly with contemporary artists, and they reflect on aspects that intersection between art and culture. And there are hands-on things to do. There's a lot of activity in there, and I've noticed that the arts groups they get a big kick out of being in the space and being able to touch things. But it's not just them. Everybody likes the space. If you visit the museum, that's one of the most
So when you say touch things, obviously museums are about objects, whether you're touching them or looking at them. So objects must be a particular focus of what docents learn how to use versus sitting around talking about concepts or free-floating ideas.
Absolutely. All of our museum tours are focused on the objects. I mean, that's the point of coming to the museum. And so the docents are trying to engage our visitors of any age, actually, in a conversation. And the conversation is around the objects and ideas that the objects might generate, whether or not it's making a connection to a personal memory, a connection to another time and place, a connection to ideas that we might be familiar with. But the object is at the center.
And
it's really cool because objects are immediate. They're there. You don't actually need to know anything about an object to have a conversation about it.
And like what? Like a painting, obviously.
Right.
But an object, what are some of the other objects that you might have there? A piece of sculpture?
We have sculpture, we have decorative arts, things people might have in their homes. We have video pieces. It runs the gamut.
I remember once I was there, and you mentioned it, there was an exhibition, or you mentioned it to me earlier, there's an exhibition of dresses and costumes. Mm-hmm. It wasn't costumes, it was just sort of formal wear. What was that exhibition?
Clothes that belonged to a woman, Iris Atfell, and she lives in New York City. She and her husband ran a fabric, Old World Weavers. They created really high-end fabrics. And she's a fabulous dresser, and she's been on best dress lists forever.
So it wasn't she wasn't a fashion designer.
No.
Oh, these were her own clothes.
I got it. Yeah. So she didn't design the clothes.
Right.
I mean, she might have suggested to a designer. And they're just fabulous. And we did have a museum network, an arts museum network visit. And when the Iris Atfell exhibition was there, we took everybody in there because whether you're a man, a woman, whether you're a child or an older person, I mean, the clothing was just so fantastic. It was just fun to look at. And I remember one visit, there was a woman who came in I don't remember what nursing home or assisted living she was living in, but she had kind of a, when she came in, she had sort of a been there, done that kind of attitude. Wasn't really anything particularly noticeable, just a little bit, like she wasn't sure she really wanted to be here.
That's what you felt.
That's what I felt.
By looking at her, that's what you thought.
Yeah, right, you know, she might have been thrilled to be there. Yeah, that's right. Thank you. Yeah. So we went up into the exhibition, and it's more just wandering around and looking and just talking personally with people. You know, what do you think of that pocketbook? Look at those boots. And, you know, how about that? You put pink and green together. But as we were leaving the exhibition, this woman said, well, I need to postpone dying. There's so much more I need to see.
Wow.
Yeah.
So really, what's interesting to me about that in part is that here's somebody who, if you look at it from the outside, looks mm-hmm. like they're just looking around like this, but something's going on inside. And mm-hmm. that's true for everybody. You know, I'm sure that you have student groups where the students look around like this and you go, wow, he's not paying any attention at all. And then he walks out and says, that was the best hour I spent.
Exactly.
You know, long time.
And I mean, that's, I mean, I hope that's one of the reasons for visiting a museum or really for any experience. I mean, there's just so much to see. And hopefully you'll just never see it all. And that when, you know, a visit perhaps to our museum or any museum, it's a chance to see something that you wouldn't ordinarily get to see.
There's a definition that I don't remember where I heard it of a good conversation, which is one that when you end it, you didn't want to end it. You wanted to have more.
Mm-hmm.
So a good conversation and a good visit to a museum is one where you say, I had to come back. I haven't seen it either at all, or I haven't seen the next experience, had the next experience.
Well, that's what we strive to do at the PBD Essex Museum. You feel like you've never had, and you've never seen it all. And there's always a reason to come back and see something more. And that's true for everybody.
Now, it's really experience, right? In other words, the reason it works as a tour for older people, well, younger people, my guess is, if they come as a school group, they have to have, you know, the teacher says we're trying to teach them about ships, so let's go to the exhibition where there are some ships. Whereas when you're older, you don't go to learn about a specific topic. It's to sort of have a learning experience.
Mm-hmm.
How does that work? How do the docents guide any older group, whether they have cognitive challenges or not, through any of the exhibitions you use to help them have that experience? What do they ask questions? Do they point out things? Do they have them talk to each other? What do you observe, or if you've done it?
Yeah.
I'm sure you've done a tour or two.
Well, I think one of the, basically just exactly what you described. I mean, the goal is for the visitors to have an experience, object-centered, as we described, social, conversational. So we do, we perhaps might start by asking visitors, regardless of who they are, you know, make some observations about what it is we're looking at. Are there things you're curious about? Is there anything you notice? Does it remind you of anything?
So you're asking them questions rather than telling them,
exactly,
this is what you're looking at.
Exactly.
Okay.
That comes later. First is just making observations, and then those comments and observations can then guide the discussion. So, for example, if we're talking about a coffee cup and they say, well, I notice it's gray and, you know, there's sort of these dots at the top, that might lead the docent, oh, well, you know, this particular potter is really interested in this gray color. You know, what if it was red? Would that change your mind? Do you have a favorite mug? What does it look like?
Yes.
And why is it your favorite mug? And go from there. We also, though, hope that, so we layer in information based on what visitors seem to be interested in, and the only way to do that is by getting them to talk about the object. I mean, I believe that most visitors, you know, they do want some information. So it's just not noting all of the observations.
What do you think? It's not only what do you think.
Right.
But as you said, you ask, what do you think and what do mm-hmm. you see? And then you say, well, this particular artist liked the color, or this particular ceramicist did it one way or another.
Right.
So you're feeding the information in, but in the context of their question.
Exactly. Exactly.
And actually, you know, you talked about, you start with an observation or a perception that someone mm-hmm. has, which everybody has. In other words, there's never a situation where if you say, what do you think about this studio? What do you think about my red sweater? What do you think about being here? What do mm-hmm. you think about my glasses?
Right.
That somebody can't say either, I like it, I don't like
it. Exactly.
And that's yeah. a real simple choice to
right.
make. And whether you're a young kid or an older person or an older person with cognitive challenges, you can always say, I like it, I don't like it.
Exactly, which is what it's so cool about an object. It's a starting point, and everybody's starting from scratch.
So
it doesn't matter.
Right, everybody's starting from scratch.
Yeah.
And that scratch is not a blank sheet.
Right.
There's some judgment in all of us about
right.
something.
Right.
Like you said, what's your favorite color?
Right.
Well, if that doesn't work, you say, is red or blue more favorite
right.
for you? You can always get there.
Yeah.
But I was also thinking that, there's a French term called objet médiateur, which means the mediating object.
Mm-hmm.
And everything is a mediating object.
Right.
So when you're dealing with other people, again, old people, young people, adults, having something in front of you when you're conversing makes it easier.
Right.
So why do we have power lunches?
Right.
Why do we say, let's meet for lunch and talk about it,
mm-hmm.
rather than let's sit someplace and stare at each other?
Right.
Because the lunch becomes the object. You don't necessarily discuss the lunch, but at some point you're going to say, oh, isn't this food good? Or the food's slow cutting here, or I like fish better than I like, or I'm a vegetarian. So that the object begins to grow the conversation.
Exactly.
And the museum is full of objects.
Right. Right.
And in fact, an infinite number of objects,
right.
if you think about it,
mm-hmm.
because every object can be looked at in 20 different, an infinite number of ways.
Almost infinite number of ways, exactly.
So
yeah.
so in a funny way, the experience of a museum is a conversation generator.
Exactly. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Isn't that interesting?
Mm-hmm.
Because actually what we miss as we get older, talking about hopeful
mm-hmm.
aging, is conversation.
Right.
You know, we get lonely. Why do we get
right.
lonely? Because people don't talk to us.
Right.
And if you have a cognitive issue, people say, oh, I don't even know what to talk about.
Right.
Well, you go to a museum and you say, let's look at that painting,
exactly.
let's look at that ship, let's look at that object, or in the nature one, which is even more connected.
Mm-hmm.
It immediately generates what museums are for.
Right. And another, you see people doing things when you go out into the community.
Yes.
You know, I've noticed when groups with the Museum Network Arts, the Museum Network, visit the museum and there are children around, you know, the big smiles. They see some life, you know, they're out of their room, they're out in the community, in a safe environment where people are.
Yeah, so safety, there's two things.
Yeah.
One is the kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I once went, my colleague and your colleague, Sean Caulfield, who's the director of,
mm-hmm.
the creative director of the foundation and the inventor of this arts program, we were at the Harvard Natural History Museum with a few people, and they, you know, looked very old and not know exactly where they were, and there were some kids. And all of a sudden, the kids were talking to them, and they were sort of talking to the kids, and I hadn't done this much before,
yeah.
and I said to myself, oh, you know, it'll be a little tense. And the kids played, they talked to the kids went away. Those kids had absolutely no idea
right.
that this person might have lived in a nursing
yeah.
home.
Yeah, that's so nice.
Isn't that
yeah.
nice?
Yeah, I think it's wonderful.
And I bet you see that a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, where mm-hmm. where the fact that somebody might have a cognitive issue or might have Alzheimer's just doesn't show up.
It really doesn't on the tour. I mean, if you were observing these groups, you would never really know. Because, as we've talked about, the object is the conversation starter, and anybody can say something about something that's in front of them.
There was just an article a while ago in the New York Times about a woman, a psychologist at Harvard named Ellen Langer. And what her research says, if you take old people and you put them in a context that's 20 years earlier where they're 50 rather than 70, and everything is that, and you say, now just behave that way, think
yeah.
that way.
Yeah.
Their vision gets better, their heart gets better, everything gets better. And the inverse would be, if you tell someone you're a sick person, they're going to act more like a
yeah.
sick person. And what it seems to me from what you're describing is that in the museum, they're treated like people. So
right.
they become people.
Right.
And those symptoms that people associate with either old age or old age with a cognitive issue is irrelevant.
Right.
And maybe you are making them better.
I hope so, or even for the moment, or even for the hour that they're at the museum.
Yes.
You know, they've had an experience that was enjoyable, that will.
Yes.
Yeah.
But also you're treating, you're, when you ask them the question, what do you think? You're not talking down to them. You're talking like you talk to anybody.
We use right? basically the same techniques with everyone that visits.
Isn't that great? Yeah. Isn't that great? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The Peabody Essex Museum started, first of all, it's in Salem, but it's how did it begin? What's the roots of the museum?
Well, the museum has a long history. It dates back to 1799. It's one of the oldest continuously operated museums in the country.
Well, that's great.
And this was a time Salem, a waterfront community, was involved in international trade, global trade. And ship owners, sea captains, merchants were making a lot of money through this global trade. And the museum was founded by a group called the East India Marine Society, which was a group of men.
of course.
Yeah.
In that age, of course
yeah.
it was.
And it was, who had sailed beyond the Capes. So sea captains and business agents on board ships that had sailed beyond the Capes. And basically...
The Cape of
Good Hope and Cape Horn.
Right, so South America and Africa.
Yeah,
right.
And it basically a networking organization. They were sharing information about where they were going, giving money to widows and orphans of members who'd been lost at sea. And then, but then also they were traveling around the world at a time when most people didn't get a chance to do that.
So they were collecting
stuff. Souvenirs.
Oh, wow.
And so...
Wow.
They started a museum to show off their souvenirs, and it just grew from there.
Am I right that that Salem or that harbor stayed open during the War of Independence, and didn't get closed because that East India trade was still going on?
Still going on. But Salem's harbor, smaller, shallower than some of the. So by the 1820s, there wasn't as much global trade from Salem as there was earlier, right after the American Revolution.
So yeah. that people who are visiting the museum are really stepping into history.
Yes.
Right, in one sense. But then you have a very beautiful new building.
We do.
And it was designed by
Moshe Safdie.
Moshe Safdie, who was an architect from Montreal originally,
yes.
who then was at Harvard for many years, where I taught.
Mm-hmm.
And It's quite a space when you walk in. It's like about 60, 70 feet high and light coming in from all over the
it
central
feels,
space.
I think it feels good to enter the museum because of the light that you get when you walk in. And certainly, it's a very grand space. The East India Marine Society members, our original museum space, I mean, they tried to make it as grand as they could at that time. So you can visit that when you come to the museum, East India Marine Hall.
You can go into the original hall that there was there.
Yes.
So how do people with cognitive issues coming into this big space, do they feel it's overwhelming or do you see in them, or how do you manage that process? Because all of us, when we go any place new, but a museum is one of, well, I visited you at one point and you know, I said, where am I gonna park? Well, there's a parking spot up there. Well, if you park in a certain place and go down to the basement, you're underground. How do I get there? You know, it could be confusing for anybody.
Absolutely.
So how do you manage that?
So
on these tours, for example,
everyone that's going to work with the group before they come, where they're there at least a half an hour, if not 45 minutes early, and watching for people at the door, because, like you said, for anyone, it can be an intimidating place to come into, and you don't really know what you're supposed to do next. So we greet people at the door.
Well, actually, you greeted people when they arrived by bus.
Mm-hmm. And then bring them in. To the atrium area where there's a cafe and cafe tables, and then we just sit there and gather. Everyone can.
So the table is all the cafe table that you're going to use is already set up for this.
Right.
So it's a destination. It's not like wandering around.
No. Right. So we go right down and sit down and let everybody just sort of get relaxed, hang up their coats, and then we do a brief introduction there in the atrium while everyone's sitting down, and then.
Introduction of people to each other or of the whole tour and say why we're here?
Both. Everybody gets a name tag. They mostly know each other, but certainly the docents don't know them.
No, right.
And so it's a chance for them to get to know them, talk a little bit about them, you know, where do they live, where are they from, and then go off on the tour, which, as I had mentioned before, is really just we pick galleries that we think the visitors will enjoy, the group will enjoy.
Well, the intro to this show has us looking at a huge model of a ship.
Right.
What is that? The Queen?
It's the Queen Elizabeth.
The Queen Elizabeth model. And it came from the original offices of
the... It did, on Fifth Avenue.
Of the Cunard line, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's huge. Mm-hmm. What is it? 20 feet? I mean, it's for people who haven't seen it, it's quite an event.
And you can imagine when you were walking down Fifth Avenue and you saw that in their offices in the window. Oh, I want to go on that ship.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The issue of safety seems to me to be very important. Mm-hmm. And there's two types of safety. One, or feeling safe. I don't mean safety from assaults, but you know, one is the safety of knowing I'm not going to fall, I'm safe physically. But the other safety is the safety of feeling that I'm cared for.
Right.
And really what you're describing is the fact that these programs, and your docents, and the guards, and the guides, all of them know that from the time they get there till the time they leave, they've got to be made to feel comfortable.
Right.
So in fact, sitting for a few minutes and saying, who are you, and where are you from, and what's new? In fact, I came to one, and it turns out that the gentleman there was a sociologist from Columbia, where I went to school.
Yeah.
So you know, in fact, there are connections made. But that whether he remembered that I was what we talked about or not, he felt safe.
Right.
And I think one of the real contributions to the field that you are making, the museum is making, is creating a safe place.
And absolutely. We're conscious of that right from the minute they enter until the moment they leave. You know, the museum's goal is that we are welcoming a safe place for everyone.
So,
regardless.
First of all, so when you say everyone.
Everyone.
See, one of the interesting things that, if you know, we have a constitution in the United States that says, you know, it says everyone has the right to this and the right for that. But there were a lot of people who were excluded at the time of the Constitution being written that were excluded from those rights for color or gender or location or whatever. And in many organizations, not necessarily museums, but in other organizations, if somebody says, but my mother can't remember things, my mother might get upset, they say, well, we don't really mean for everyone, including her. And you've, through this program, created a truly inclusive everyone. And so when you describe the museum being for everyone, that's pretty profound. It's a pretty profound goal.
And we're thinking about it all the time, you know, and there are just the way we are, you know, thinking about things we might be doing, even unconsciously, that might make it seem unwelcoming for certain groups of people. We're really actively thinking about how to make sure that we are welcoming, everyone feels respected.
There's a movement among the disability groups where 30 years ago, when you said the disabled, whatever that means, have to be able to get someplace, we thought ramps, places for the wheelchairs to be put, that was it. And there's a whole movement in that field that says cognitive barriers are just as important as physical barriers. So if the signs aren't clear, if people aren't welcoming, if people ask you questions you can't answer, that's as much of a barrier as a staircase for someone who can't get upstairs.
Right, right.
So really also you're broadening the definition of accessibility, because accessibility has to be all of us, not just whether we can climb a stair. It has to include, can we comprehend the sign? Can we comprehend there's a stair?
Right.
So there's the interesting thing, another interesting thing about this whole program is the impact it has, not on the docents, not on the people, but on others at the museum and others beyond the museum who aren't sitting there. And I know two things. One is we were on the phone the other day and talking about this, and I'm going to ask you that at the end. You got a little note from one of the people in your open office that said something, but you didn't tell me exactly what it was, but I'm going to ask.
Okay.
But the other thing is, in this Peabody Essex Museum Connections magazine, you had an article about the program called Art for All.
Art for All, so PEM for everybody, and it includes
It says,
a note.
There are photographs of it. It says a place for children. It says appreciation for arts never fades. And that really, in fact, there's a photograph here.
Yep.
That went to your whole membership.
It did.
So by having this kind of program, it's not only the few people who hear it, it's about how many members do you have, give or take?
Thousands, maybe around 11,000.
That's a lot. So yeah. 10,000 people, yeah. give or take,
yeah.
or 10,000 families, that's
families,
even more.
Families, it's family, yeah.
You know, read mm-hmm. this and say, wow, there's something I could do. And they don't have to sit home alone.
Right.
They say, wow, maybe I will go to the museum.
And people,
go on.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
People have commented that they are so excited that we're involved in this
yeah.
program.
Well, that's you know, you change the world, you drop a pebble in the water, and the ripples
right.
go on, and then
right.
hopefully they hit the shore and they keep going.
Right.
And I think that's a fabulous contribution to this whole question of accessibility and accessibility for everyone
right.
as we age,
right.
cognitively challenged or not,
right.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
And to my mind, just so you know, I think we're all cognitive challenged as we get older.
Well, I know I am, and I always have been.
So,
yeah.
you know, I have to right. have my notes, I have to have yeah. my mm-hmm. iPhone with the,
right.
With the mm-hmm. words. And, you know, I forget names, or I forget mm-hmm. this, or I forget that. So what?
Right.
And if people start treating me with what I forget, I'm going to get old quick.
Right.
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 So what did this, what was the note you received? From your office mate, if I can go.
Right, so that goes to the idea of, you know, well, if you're not going to remember, why bother to do it? Because they're not going to remember it.
Oh, that's something a lot of people say.
Yeah.
Why bother?
Right.
They won't remember
right.
next week.
Right. But then as I was thinking, well, I don't remember what I did yesterday. So, and it really doesn't matter what you did yesterday. It only matters what you're doing right this minute. And who knows how it's touching someone. And in a lot of cases, we'll never know. But anyway, my coworker, her brother is Griff Evans, is a songwriter. And this is what he told her, and so she was sent it off to me. The unconscious can be influenced by our experiences, even if it leaves our conscious memory.
Yeah. Well, that's mm-hmm. that's a profound, if I may say so again, message.
Right.
You know, just because mm-hmm. we can't consciously know something doesn't
right.
mean we don't know it.
Exactly. And it doesn't mean it didn't affect us.
And it doesn't mean it didn't occur.
Right, absolutely, yeah.
There's an old Zen mm-hmm. koan, which is, if a tree falls in the forest and nobody hears it, does it make a sound?
Mm-hmm.
Well, on that note, which is a question with no answer, Ellen, thank you so much
oh,
for coming.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for having me.
And,
a pleasure.
Thank you all for being here, and come back again.